Today, I am here to give you a look at a day in the life of an attractions cast member.
You're rotating down positions, like down the list.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Welcome back, pirates. Please make sure to gather up all your treasures. Any emergencies, like, it's you.
Fireworks start at 9:20 tonight.
I loved working pack. This is like the most well-oiled machine I have ever seen in my life.
We have our heading.
Here we go!
Hey guys, my name is Paige, and I was an attractions cast member at Walt Disney World at Pirates of the Caribbean in my Disney College program in 2022, and today I'm here to give you a look at a day in the life of an attractions cast member. This is part two of a two-part series. Part one goes a little bit more into general detail about the attractions role and just kind of being a cast member at Disney World in general, like hours, wages, tips that I have, guest interactions, things like that. So if you haven't seen part one, I would recommend you go watch that part first so that you have a kind of general idea of what I'm talking about here. But this is part two, so I'm gonna be going in detail over all the positions you might be working in a day. And I'm also gonna be talking about fireworks and PAC, parade audience control shifts today, because those are shifts that you may be working as an attractions cast member. Also, just a little disclaimer before we get started, this is not a training video or a video that is telling you how to do your job if you get hired at Disney World. It's just a video to just give you an idea of what a typical workday at Disney World might look like. Yeah, let's get started.
So a typical day might look like this. So you're gonna go up to your little handy dandy computer that is the same place that you clock in, and it's gonna be in like your specific like break room backstage area for your attraction that you might share with other attractions in the area. You're pulling an assignment. So you can pull four different kinds of assignments, if that makes sense. So the first thing that you can pull is rotation. Rotation goes around every 45 minutes or so. I'm gonna go into detail about that one in just a minute, but the other three kinds of assignments you can pull are, you can pull a break, which means you can pull your own break, or you can pull somebody else's break, most likely somebody else's break. Whatever position they're in, you're gonna go to that random position and you're going to give them their break and you're gonna take their place, which means that you could be, if they've been in that position for like 20, 25 minutes already, you might only be in that position for like 20 more minutes. The next assignment you can pull is the most coveted assignment, which I'll go ahead and talk about right now, which is pulling a task, which lasts 10 minutes long, and it'll usually tell you what kind of task it is. So like it might say like, go sweep the queue, go give somebody a bathroom break. My favorite one to pull was like, go make a magical moment. That's your magical moment opportunity as an attractions cast member. Of course you can kind of make something happen at any time, but that's the best time to do it. You would have 10 minutes and you would go make something magical happen, like go out and interact with some kids, swear them in as pirates, or hand out some stickers or tattoos, or give somebody a nose strings. I would wait for somebody with like a anniversary or wedding, or mainly like a birthday button, and I'd send them straight through Lightning Lane. My fellow cast members really appreciate it if you take that time to like go around and ask them if they need anything. So that's pulling a task.
So let's say that you just clocked in. So let's say you pull rotation. So that means that you're going to go to the very first position at the top of that list. You're going to give that slip of paper to the person that's already in that position. You're now in their position. They're going to leave their position and go to the next position on the list, give the slip of paper to the next person. So essentially, you're just rotating down positions, like down the list. For us, there were two different rotations going on at once. There was port rotation and starboard rotation. And so all of the positions happening on the starboard side of the water are starboard rotation, and all the ones happening on the port side are port side rotation. And then there's also some like other positions mixed into both of the rotations. So there's two rotations happening at once. So let's say that you get to the computer and you pull port rotation. You are headed to the first position on the list, which is wheelchair. So the wheelchair position at my attraction is basically what we would call the people that would assist people that use wheelchairs or mobility devices, right? So they would be standing right where people load onto the boats.
Row one, we have the next one. Not this one, the next one.
if you see someone that uses a mobility device, you would basically be their wheelchair like valet. They would leave the chair and you would fold up the chair and you would bring that and any other chairs that come in the next like 2 minutes, you would take that and you would walk them all the way across Adventureland to the exit, like through crowds of guests, because unfortunately, at least in Pirates of the Caribbean, there is like no way that you can bring those chairs through the backstage area because it's just like stairs at like everywhere. We had 8 minutes to get there because the ride is 8 minutes long. Sometimes like wheelchair is really chill because like nobody will come through. And so you'll just be like sitting there, just like chilling in the air conditioning. And then some days, for some reason, there will just be like tons and tons of mobility devices all at once. And there are usually two or three people in the wheelchair position at once. So like people will be like helping you, but sometimes you'll just be like running back and forth in the heat. Yeah, that's wheelchair. So then you've been there for like 45 minutes and rotation comes around. So somebody hands you the slip of paper and you walk yourself over to the next position on the list, which is port load, and you hand the slip of paper to port load. So now you are on port load and that's where you're actually operating the ride. So you're sending the boats. You're in charge if anybody like puts their hand in the water or stands up in the boat, you have to stop it. You're just opening the gates, closing the gates, sending the boats. It seems really intimidating when you first start. It becomes almost mindless. Grouper was my absolute favorite position. You're the person that is telling people what rows to be in.
4, 5, 6, how many?
So you're standing right before people get onto the ride and you're saying like how many?
One.
Each attraction is different, like how many people can be seated in a row. Ours was 4. So if they say 5 people, then I'll say, okay, rows 1 and 2, please. And you have to go like so fast. Some people are like making row requests and depending how busy you are, you can decide to accommodate or not accommodate that. You have to like keep an eye on like which rows have been seated. It's a constant mind game. You feel like you're playing Tetris. You just feel like you're just like super, super on your toes, but like in the best way. And it would literally go by so fast. 45 minutes in grouper feels like 5. It's great. I love grouper. You're typically only gonna be in about 3 positions before somebody pulls your break. Every 2 hours, you should be getting your break. So you're gonna go take your 15-minute break, and then you're gonna finish your break, you're gonna go back up to the computer, and you're gonna pull another assignment. And like I said, you could pull another rotation, which means you start right back at the top, or you could pull somebody's break or bump out, or you could pull a task. So let's say you finish your break, you go back up to the computer, and we're just gonna say that for some reason this is a super orderly day, just so I can tell you about all the positions. You pull somebody's break. You pulled mast. You're gonna take over their position, they're gonna go on to break. So mast, that's where you're standing at the front and you're literally just greeting everybody, just making sure that people know that they can't bring their drinks or food into the boat. You're just checking to make sure that nothing is coming through the queue that isn't supposed to. It's super chill. You're literally just basically standing there and greeting people and just keeping an eye out for things. So let's say you're in mast now because you pulled somebody's break. You're only there for 15 minutes and rotation comes around. So you are on to the next position. Your next position is merge. This is the position that everybody makes fun of at Disney because it's the... I don't know why, like tell me why people think it's so funny. It's where you're merging Lightning Lane and the normal standby line. The standby line has, like, that queue has been, like, looping through the building for a while, but Lightning Lane is just, like, walking all the way up to this point really quickly. Typically, if we weren't super busy, Lightning Lane would just kind of get their own side. We'd mostly just be doing this. We'd be like, yeah, just keep going to your correct side.
Well, please continue down that way and continue up there.
Thank you.
Where merge gets complicated is if there aren't that many people in Lightning Lane, but the standby line is like 50 minutes long. You might like ask the Lightning Lane people to stop for like 2 seconds so you can send a bunch of the standby people down to the starboard side so that you can shorten that line a little bit. Or sometimes the other way around. You'd have to stop the standby line and have the Lightning Lane people go on both sides because the Lightning Lane has to move really fast. You're doing traffic control. That's what merge is. So then you get rotation again and you are headed to Lightning Lane Entry Assist. I'm gonna talk about like fully like lightning lane in a second because that is on the other rotation, the starboard rotation. But essentially you're going to be standing there like with an iPad and you're going to just be helping people scan their magic bands if they're having troubles. You're going to be telling people in the line, like, make sure you have your magic bands ready. You're going to be there as an extra point where people can scan in with your iPad instead of the touch points if the line gets too long. And then you're also just helping with any issues that might occur. So if somebody starts arguing, they don't have a reservation and they're like, I have one, then the assist job is to like pull them off to the side so that the lightning lane person can continue to do their main job. And then lastly, you do get sent to enlistment registration. This is a very pirate specific position, but it's just a good example of what it can look like if you are working more than one attraction, because enlistment registration was our pirate's treasure of the seven seas, whatever, scavenger hunt, that treasure hunt that we would do in the park.
You seek the treasure of the Pacific?
And it's just listed on there like a rotation. We just would leave our Pirates of the Caribbean and we would go over to the other attraction and we would work that for 45 minutes. And you would just stand there for 45 minutes and just like explain to people like what it is. And you would give out treasure maps. And then if people like completed a treasure map, you would give them their little card, like their little prize. And it was the best time to have magical moments and like interactions with kids because it's so quiet there and it's just you. So you might have like little things in your attraction like that where you just have like the opportunity to just talk with guests. Continuing with our day on the job, so let's say that you're at the game and somebody comes in and they're like, I pulled your lunch. And so you're like, great. And so you head back to the break room, you clock out because it's unpaid, and you head off to your lunch, which means that you get 30 or 45 minutes, depending on your attraction, to just chill and eat and get food. And there's a lot of little break rooms around. There's quite a little bit of a walk to like every break room, especially in Magic Kingdom. So a lot of people just bring their own food so we could just chill in our own little break room. So then you come back from your lunch, you pull starboard rotation. So now you're headed to starboard load, which is the exact same as port load. I already explained it, but now you're on starboard side. The rotation comes around and now you're at starboard grouper. So you're grouping for starboard and that side is super chill. Then somebody comes around with rotation. And so you head over to lightning lane entry. Lightning lane entry is the person that has the power to see if they have a lightning lane, and you can't really do much there, but you can basically just see this person has a reservation, this person doesn't, and you can also see people's names. If they don't have a reservation, then we can see like no reservation made at all, or we can see reservation for Peter Pan at 7:45 p.m. The other thing that you have as a lightning lane person is you're doing a lot of overrides. I would override if they were like 6 minutes early, you know? I would just be like, yeah, go through. Like, I'm not gonna sit here and argue because you're 6 minutes early. So I would override if they were just a tiny bit early. So that's lightning lane. Let's say at that point, you get your next break, you go off for 15 minutes, and you pull somebody's bump out, which means that they're going home, who is waiting at Mass 2. Mass 2 is basically like they're helping the person at the front, like Mass 1, but mostly Mass 2 kind of hangs out more like inside the queue and like the line area, and they're in charge of resetting all of the ropes and the chains. As more people come, you have to add more ropes and chains, which can be kind of confusing at first because it's just like a maze and you have to figure out in your brain like which ones to set up and stuff, but you catch on pretty fast. And then sometimes if the line gets really long, like you might be standing all the way out at the entrance with like a sign saying like line starts here in like the heat, you might open up the extended queue and you might be asked to take down the entire extended queue if it's later in the night. So yeah, you're basically dealing with like the lines. So then rotation comes around and you are now going to unload one. That's where you go to the exit where guests are gonna be getting off the boat. We would be standing at the console there. We'd be in charge of sending the boats like up the up ramp after the guests got off the boat. And at the same time that that happens, more guests would be coming in to exit. And you're again, making sure nobody like stands on the boat preemptively. And you're also spieling and being like, this is my spiel. I'd be like, welcome back pirates. Please make sure to gather up all your treasures and watch your step as you abandon ship. I think that's what I said.
Welcome back, pirates.
Some people talked in like a full-on pirate voice.
Please have all your cargo and kindly watch your step ashore.
Amazing.
Some people will be more themed than others. I like to get kind of into it. And you can come up with like your own little things to say that like would make people laugh. Some people would sing. Sometimes I would be like, "Welcome back, pirates. Can I please get an R?" And everybody would be like, "R!" I would do that if I was in a really good mood and everybody was being nice that day. And especially if I saw like a lot of like little kids in the boat. Yeah, people got different levels of into it. I liked Unload. I think it can be boring if you just stand there and you're like, watch your step, watch your step, watch your step. But it's as fun as you make it. You're making sure to let people know where the like wheelchair exit is.
Sometimes, if you have to get out of the elevator, eventually the doors will close and you'll be able to use it again.
Yeah, Unload's pretty chill. And then Tower. So you get your next rotation, you head over to Tower. Not every ride has a tower, right? Like I think It's a Small World has a tower. I don't know if this is 100% true, but I think it's like if you have like a boat ride or like a major roller coaster, then you probably have Tower. I don't think like Little Mermaid or like Peter Pan have a tower. It's a big console. It's kind of like the load console, except I don't have a video of it because it's very backstage. But it is like the load console, except times 10. Like, it is massive. And you are basically up there, you're sitting up in this like little window where you have a view of all the guests, and you are like the overlord of the ride. So you have like ultimate control over the ride. And you can also completely start up and completely shut down the ride. And if an emergency happens, like if the ride detects somebody got out of the boat in the middle of the ride, or if there's like a fire, or if there's any sort of emergency, you're the first one that hears that. There's like alarms everywhere, and you are like in charge of dealing with the initial reaction. Like you have to call the coordinator, call 911 if you have to. Like any emergencies, like it's you. And so I was like, you're always a little bit on edge. Like nothing major ever happened to me while I was in Tower, but it happened to a lot of CPs that I knew. I could never fully relax in Tower because I was always just like, what if it happens while I'm here? Like, what if I have to do it? Even if there's just like an auto-y, the ride just like has a problem for some reason. Nothing emergency. It just like shuts down for a second. Like it has a technical difficulty.
Attention, your voyage has been temporarily delayed. Please remain seated in your boat, as it may begin moving at any time.
You're the person that has to sit there and deal with that.
When they opened Disneyland in 1956, nothing worked.
Yeah, but John, if the Pirates of the Caribbean breaks down, the pirates don't eat the tourists.
So yeah, there's just a lot of things that you're doing. You have cameras of like throughout the entire ride, so while like the load consoles are only in charge of like until the boats go into the ride, Tower can see most of the ride. And so like if somebody sticks their hand in the water or stands up in the boat in the middle of the ride, we can spiel to any point in the ride. We can like literally stop the music and be like,
please remain seated and keep all hands, arms, feet, and legs inside the boat at all times.
You're not guest facing, you are the safety person. In our ride, the ride required both load consoles and then finally Tower to finally send the boat. And we all three had to be pushing down the button for the boats to go. But it wasn't until Tower pressed it that it could go. Yeah, if you're closing Tower or opening Tower, you're basically closing and opening the ride. Like you're the person that's there first and there last. A lot of people liked it. It's the only time you really get away from the music. It's dead silent in there. It's dark. You get to sit in a chair and it's just like nice and peace and quiet. But I just hated it because I was just like constantly stressed that like something was gonna happen. But you know, to each his own, that's Tower. You get rotation one more time. You're just gonna go spend like 10 minutes down at Wheelchair Valet, our shaded area. It was really specifically for this purpose where people could park their ECVs, their scooters that they weren't allowed to bring into the queue. You're just telling them like where to park their scooter. Without help, people will just like park them in random spots in like the middle of nowhere, and it'll get like so congested in there that like people can't go in there or leave. It was kind of tiring sometimes because you would spend 20 minutes putting all the scooters into neutral so that you could manually like push them into places they were supposed to go so that people could like get in and leave. So sometimes that would be kind of like a physically exhausting position. Oh, and you know what? I just realized one position that I did not capture on these pictures, because it must not have been up at the time, is stroller parking. Stroller parking is part of the rotation for a lot of attractions. If you have a stroller parking near your attraction, it's not always up because sometimes they just have a lot of stroller parking people. Like they just have three people already working the area. But if we're like really overstaffed, it might be on the rotation. You just tell people, yes, this is where you park your stroller. And you just move them if they're too far apart or if they're in the wrong spot. So yeah, I think that's like literally all the positions, unless I missed something, but that was all the positions that were at Pirates of the Caribbean. In the same way that there are absolutely positions on there that are not in other rides, I'm sure that there are other positions in other attractions that we didn't need at Pirates that I don't know about. So that's not like everything that you're gonna do, and you're not gonna do everything on that list, but that kind of gives you like a rundown of like what a typical day might look like and the positions you might go through. I hope that gave you guys a little bit of a rundown, a little bit of clarity about what the attraction position really looks like.
Become a part of the magic, for the time has come to take your places and prepare to welcome the wondrous and wonderful Disney Festival of Fantasy Parade!
So I also just wanted to pop in here for a second just to talk about PAC and fireworks. For one, because I have heard of people when they get the role of attractions, you can be assigned as a PAC person. So like PAC is a role. And then on top of that, if you are working in Magic Kingdom, if you get anything in the Liberty Square, Adventureland, or Frontierland, you're going to be doing PAC for the Festival of Fantasy Parade. Pretty much just like any attractions cast member in Magic Kingdom, there's a solid chance that, especially as a CP, you're going to be trained in fireworks. I don't know about the other parks. I don't know if they help out with like Fantasmic and stuff, but just know that if you get attractions, there's a solid chance that you might be working PAC and or fireworks. Starting with PAC. PAC stands for Parade Audience Control. So if you were just working PAC that day, your shift would typically go from about 10:45 in the morning until 4:45 p.m. because we would be specifically working the Festival of Fantasy Parade. And that parade happens at least it did while I worked there. It happened at 12 p.m. and 3 p.m. But there would also be times where you would just be working PAC for the first half of the day and your attraction for the second half of the day. So like the Frontierland people where the parade came out would be only working Frontierland. At Liberty Square Adventureland people, we would be working the Liberty Square section of the parade. And then the PAC people would take entirely over for once it gets out to like Main Street and the castle area. So you would start out the day by going to a computer and you would clock in and you would pull an assignment like you would at an attraction. You would pull a position and it would essentially be your physical location that you're gonna be working for the parade. So like there's a specific spot that you have to stand during the parade. Wherever you're standing would often come with a responsibility for like the takedown of the parade. So it was just like completely random. Like you would get a different one for every PAC shift and that would be your position for the entire PAC shift for both parades. The first thing we would do is we would pull that position and then we would immediately do setup. And that was pretty unorganized. It was basically just like everybody help with the setup. You would get these like huge carts that had what we called stanchions. You would have this like big heavy thing that would kind of hurt with the rope on it that would physically roll. You would use that to set up the ropes and to take them down. We would all just kind of help with like setting up the ropes, setting up the stanchions. There were like little plugs in the ground that you had to take out of the ground and that's where the stanchions would go. That would take like 15 minutes with everybody working together. I loved working PAC in Liberty Square, guys. Like we had the coolest people. It was super super cool because we got to work with all of the attractions people from like all the rides in Adventureland and Liberty Square. And the coolest thing is you could wear any Adventureland or Liberty Square costume. So like we could be a mansion maid for the day. I always wore a Jungle Cruise skipper costume. It was like the costume that kept you the coolest on a hot day. Pack is hot. Some of this might be very specific to working the Adventureland Liberty Square section of PAC, because like I know Frontierland people, every time that they were between like setup, takedown, and parades, they had to go back to their attraction and physically work their attraction, which is exhausting. I don't know how they did that. I think the major reason for that is because they are like right next to their attraction, where a lot of us were from Adventureland, and that would have been like a whole situation to get back to and from Adventureland to like be pulling assignments. So we didn't have to do that. We had it like so chill. We would do the setup, which would take like 15 minutes. And then it would depend on the coordinator. So some coordinators wanted you to be standing out there the whole time, like interacting with guests, doing activities.
I'm not totally sure the weather. Grand Marshal.
And then some coordinators were super chill, and we would just go sit above the HOP, the Hall of Presidents break room. And like, we would literally just like hang out this entire shift, guys. Like it was so fun. And we would like play group games on our phones, like Jackbox and stuff. I loved PAC shifts. So the PAC people were in charge of like the cavalcades, anything that went through Main Street. So like when the cavalcades came through, we didn't have to be there for that. It wasn't until like 10:30 that we really had to like be out there doing our job. And so the first thing we would do is we'd spend like 20-30 minutes basically just starting to redirect traffic. So all we had to do was just turn Liberty Square into one-way traffic. So like you couldn't walk down the middle of the street towards Frontierland because that's where the parade was going to be coming from. So we wanted to start, essentially we were just kind of trying to start getting people out of the middle of the street and like behind the ropes. Super easy. And then the parade would come through and we got to watch the Festival of Fantasy twice a day during those pack shifts. And as a cast member, like it's so much fun because the characters like start to like get to know who you are. They just interact with cast members the most. And so like all the characters would start funny quips with you because it was like entertaining for the audience. It was just so much fun. You basically just watch the parade, but you also have responsibilities the entire time. You would basically just make sure that like no kids are like leaning on the ropes. And then the biggest thing that people would do is they would go standing on like big ledges. So you always had to yell at people and be like, hey guys, I need you to like step down. And then if you have a takedown responsibility, which most of the positions do, you're doing your takedown responsibilities right behind the parade. And then all of the guests, there's like a huge crowd of guests, are walking right behind your takedown responsibilities. So you're taking it down so quick. And this is like the most well-oiled machine I have ever seen in my life. The first couple times it's so stressful because you're going so quick. So basically it starts with like the clippers are unclipping the ropes. The rollers are physically rolling up the ropes. And then there's somebody pulling the cart that's going to hold all of the stanchions. And then there's usually somebody extra that's like taking the stanchions out after all the rope stuff is done and putting it into the cart for you. There is somebody that's the plugger, which is taking the, like the little plugs to plug the hole back into the ground. Trailing behind everybody, the rope holders, that's where like the huge crowd of people are following your takedown. It's like really stressful for like the 5 minutes that that's happening, but basically that means you have like 10 stressful minutes of this entire like 6 hour shift, and the rest of it is so chill. Once that is all done and you have like the whole takedown and everything, and then you've gone and put everything back in their closets, you head backstage and you have like a little meeting, and then you have lunch. Ours was so cool because depending on how nice the coordinator was, sometimes we would have like a lunch for like an hour and a half to 2 hours where we would just be like hanging out like in the Mouseketeeria. If we were ever rained out, which would happen often in the summer, that's where we were always given permission to just hang out in the HOP because we didn't have to go back to our attractions. It was fantastic. At like two, we would have to do the setup again. Basically, it would just be a repeat of what we just did because there were two parades. So we would do the whole setup again, just kind of chill. We would go back to our same positions and do the whole like directing traffic thing, do our same takedown responsibilities. And then at that point, we would head backstage again to do our final like meeting. They would always give us like popsicles because it was always super hot. If you were going to your attraction, you would just go clock in for your attraction. That was a pack shift. a fireworks shift was something that, like, pretty much any college program person in Magic Kingdom would be a part of. And the pack people would be a part of this too. Our fireworks while I was there was every night at 9:20 p.m. And you would never just have a fireworks shift because fireworks shifts would only go on for like 3 hours. And so you would be working your attraction throughout the day. And then at about 7 p.m., I think it was, you would head over to right behind the castle area backstage where all the pack people operate out of. And then we would basically just like eat dinner and we would just like chill again. Like a lot of it was just like you would get paid to just like hang out. At least while I was there for the setup, all the pack people were in charge of fireworks setup. And then around 8 p.m., we would have like our fireworks meeting with like tons of us. I think there were like 80 of us. One of like the leaders would stand there and just read out the positions, which were basically just numbers. And we got this telecast that like has like a map and it has like 80 numbers on it. Just like pack, you have an exact spot where you have to stand in the castle area. So he would basically just call out the numbers, like number one is this name, number two, this name. So you would get a number, you would look at your little map and it would tell you where you're supposed to stand and you would go grab a little light wand. You would just go head out to your designated spot. Your whole job would just be helping with audience control and flow. So there'd be tape on the ground and on one side of that tape is where guests could stand to watch the fireworks and one side of that tape they couldn't because that was where people were coming back and forth. And so we would basically just like be standing with our light wands, being like, this is a traffic area, answering any questions. My favorite place is there's like an emergency walkway that's like right behind the hubgrass that nobody can stand in. And whenever I got that section, before the fireworks would be kind of stressful because people would be trying to like set up camp there and you'd be like, hey guys, this is an emergency walkway. And so people would get kind of upset at that. But then once the actual fireworks would start, the actual pack people would close off that walkway and like stand there so nobody could even enter the emergency walkway during the fireworks. And so then you would just be kind of like standing there. And that was like the one time when you could, like in those positions, you could actually kind of watch the fireworks because nobody's in your section. So that was really cool. I loved having that section during fireworks. 5 out of like the 80 something of us were assigned an extra responsibility, which was to have a turtle box, which is a mic headset. And those people did have to like spiel to people.
Fireworks start at 9:20 tonight. 9:20 for fireworks.
And then once the fireworks are over, everybody would go stand in a line and we would be directing two-way traffic. So like we would stand in a line in the middle of the street because a lot of people leave right after fireworks. So we would help with that traffic control for like 10 minutes and we would help with taking the tape off of the streets and stuff and throwing that away. Your shift ended at like, I think like 10:15. So you gotta leave an hour to like 4 or 5 hours earlier than you would if you were working your attraction that night. So I liked fireworks shifts. Something I forgot to mention that was really cool about working attractions in Magic Kingdom, and I'm sure this is true for like a lot of roles, but I just thought it was worth mentioning because it was just so fun, is we had like this amazing view of the fireworks every night. We couldn't see the castle, but like from Pirates, it was so cool because we had like a direct view of the fireworks over the trees. And so if you were happening to work Lightning Lane or Mast during the fireworks, you got to see like the fireworks going off every night and listen to the music. So I think that's gonna be where I end this video. I hope that that gave you a little bit of a better idea of what a typical workday as an attractions cast member might look like. If there's anything that I didn't answer in the last two videos talking about attractions, please leave your comments below. I'm happy to answer. But I think that is all I have for you guys now, so I will see you guys next time. Bye.